It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die. 'Cause I don't know what's up there beyond the sky. It's been a long time coming, but I know.
The Boy Scouts. As a Boy Scout member, Pastor Nelson, Clarence T. Nelson, also invited my family, including myself, into the church. And we joined the church in 54. He came to our house to interview us, or not to interview us, but to welcome us into the church. Jet Magazine was at my house along with Pastor Nelson, my mother, her name was Mildred Davis, and myself. And we were photoed in Jet Magazine somewhere in 1954, which I'm trying to locate the picture. And we joined the church in 1954. It was a part of Operation One Mile, but I didn't know Operation One Mile was going on at that time. I just knew that they wanted me to be a member of the Boy Scouts in the community. They were opening up the community to the young men as far as Boy Scouts was concerned, and I was the first member out of that group and become a member of Augustana Lutheran Church, but also being a Boy Scout at Augustana Lutheran Church. My parents taught us about integration. Also, I was involved in a few instances when I was 6 years old and a little older, where I went to places that weren't integrated, and especially in certain playgrounds, I was asked to leave because of they didn't have any way of, they weren't used to having African Americans come to their facilities. So I was asked to leave when I did go, and I asked my parents, especially my mother, about that, and she explained to me what happened and what was the situation during that time.
How'd you feel about that?
Well, I felt hurt, but there were a lot of things I didn't understand, because my parents always taught us to accept everyone and how to deal with everyone. I was a little lost. I didn't quite understand the reason why I wasn't accepted, although color was the main issue, but we never discussed something like that in the family. We always were taught to be able to accept everyone. The church was Swedish, Norwegian, and German, mostly. And there might have been some other folks that are mixed in there. But, you know, it was, again, I won't say it was segregated, but it was an all-white church. And we came and integrated that, which means we were from the inner city, we were a block away from the church, and Pastor Nelson had vision and far ahead of his time to integrate the church. Pastor Nelson, I can't remember, was before the Jet Magazine article or afterwards, but he came and talked to us about the situation here at Augustana and what we were doing to, as we become members, what the situation may be and what the results may be from. So he mentioned that they may be maybe members that may not stay in the church because they may not agree with the integration of the church, and that we could see some members a couple of Sundays in a row, and then we wouldn't see any. Maybe some of those same members would not be here the next following Sundays. So we knew that we were doing something important. We knew that it had consequences, but we were wanted to participate because we were interested in what things that Pastor Nelson told us. No, there wasn't any fear. There was more concernment of, you know, what the future is going to bring with that. But because I was a member of the Boy Scouts and I expressed how much I enjoyed it, how much I felt comfortable with that, and my mother and father felt comfortable because of what I told them about that. And as far as becoming members, we discussed it, but there wasn't any fear. We just had faith in God that would guide us. Pastor Nelson was just a dynamic person. He had vision, focus on what the church and where the church wanted. He wanted to see the church go. He talked to us about the church. He talked to us about Augustana and the people there. And he just wanted us to feel comfortable and be a part of the church. I was the first African-American acolyte, and he wanted me to lead the pastors into our procession, be the one that represent the pastors, and I would lead the pastors in the procession in the other churches. And he had mentioned to me the first time that if anyone said any derogatory remark to me, that he would leave the church because he was protecting me, and they said they shouldn't say these things to you. Fortunately, nobody said anything. But he just gave me assurance that I could do this and that he would give me support. I think my favorite memory is when I became director of the Acolyte Corps and serving, because sometimes I believe in showing them how to do it rather than telling them how to do it. And my brothers, Bobby and Leroy, were also acolytes. And my favorite part was when we served, I was the crucifer, and they were torchbearers on each side of me, and we walked up the aisle to serve together. And that was just a fantastic moment for me, with having my brothers on each side of me. To equal that, when my children became acolyte age and I taught them the same thing, I would have my daughter on one side, that's when girls could acolyte, and I would have my son on the other side, and I was still the crucifer. And I would march in the procession with them. So those two events were very important to me and very memorable for me as the oldest of, you know, of all of that. And those are the things I'll never forget. It's hard to put in words, but I built my foundation of life through the Lutheran Church. I have been involved in so many different programs, so many different things that were, I would be the first African-American or the first one to do there. And Augustana built that foundation for me for the rest of my life, how to react, how to respond, how to speak, how to answer. It was just a wonderful experience for me, even today. I still have those foundations and those facts in my mind, which all grew up and were grown and processed right here at Augustana Lutheran Church. I think we need more fellowship. We need more talks like we did today, more community activities like we had today, more involvement from another stage of Operation 1 Mile, and more education. Education is the key to understanding the problems that we face as Americans dealing with racism. We need to educate, and more education of understanding who we are and what we're about. All of us are Americans, like Pastor Perry said, but all of us have different views on how we are as Americans. But we need to understand that every individual is important and has a say and has a right to say, coming from their culture background, coming from their life skills background, that can contribute to where we want to be in the future. The riots, it was interesting because that was 1968. I was much older. The riots were happening. I wasn't living at home. I was married. I had children. I was living up on 16th and Somerset. I was going to work. I was working for the DC Public Library. I had to catch the public transportation to come home. The impact that I had was I got off a bus, and this giant guy looked like a giant to me, you know, National Guardsman, about 6'5", with a rifle, confronted me and asked where was I going. And I told him I live 3 blocks over there, and that's where I'm headed, and that's where I'm going to stay. And that was the impression that left in me about the riots. I felt really bad about what was happening in the community, but there was another side of that people don't really think about during that riot. And why, you know, there were guys out there that were rioting that had no good in mind, and that was part of the fact. But another part was the frustration that the African community had in trying to move forward and being doors shut and being able to want to make progress, but they were not welcome. Their thoughts, words, and deeds were not heard. And the frustration just took over. And the sad thing about it, they burned their own community, and where they had to go eat, sleep, and communicate. That was the sad part of it. But if that had to, the best thing out of it, if it woke America up to the point that we have a problem, and we have to face the problem. And if America was not willing to face the problem, then there's going to be more consequences like we saw in the 1968 riots. It's Augustana was the foundation, but in 59, I went to a high school, Western High School, which is now Duke Ellington School of the Arts. I went there in 1959, which again, sort of the same situation. Predominantly white school, small group of African Americans going there to get their education. I faced the racism there. Even before that, at 16, I worked for the DC Public Library System. All of the librarians that I worked for were Miss, had the bun in the back from Mississippi, Georgia, and Alabama. So I had to deal with consequences from that, as well as the high school. High school, it wasn't that bad, but we had instances. So when 68 came around and that, I was well prepared to deal with whatever. Augustana set the foundation for me to be able to deal with anything that I had to deal with coming to racism and so forth. Even at the time, as I speak now, I spent 40 years teaching all over the United States for the federal government and for private industry. There were many times I was the only African American in the classroom, and I was the instructor. And a lot of people didn't know that. And so I've dealt with being the minority in several occasions throughout my life. But Augustana was the first entity that introduced me to that, taught me how to deal with that, as well as gave me confidence that I can deal with it. In 57, I was lucky enough to be on an integrated baseball team called Calorama Playground off of Calorama Road, Columbia Road, in that area. And I was in Look magazine as part of that issue. And that goes back to Augustana, taught me how to deal with that. A lot of the things that dealt with integration, I learned here firsthand. When Pastor Nelson asked me to stay at the church overnight, because we had a group coming from Texas, young people coming from Texas, to spend the night here in the church, and Pastor Nelson felt that I should be there and to represent the church, but also to stay overnight with them. Their main reason was to come here was to see how integration works. They said other things, but their main reason was to see how integration works, because they heard about Augustana Lutheran Church in Texas. And so they came to see what they heard, whether it was a truth or a fiction or whatever. I hope they learn that integration can work if you give it a chance. Hope they learn that African Americans are not what everybody else saying that we were. We were intelligent. You know, we had some of the same views that they had dealing with life, and that they took away a respect from me meeting them that they had for African Americans, not the disrespect or something that they don't know what they're talking about or whatever. All the things, the lies and everything that was told, hopefully they learned the truth when I stayed with them at church. If I had to tell young people, especially African-American male, that when you go into a church, first of all, you're going because you believe in Christ and you want to be forgiven by all your sins, and you want to understand what the real meaning of a church is. It's to ask for forgiveness, to ask for life under Christ's teachings, and to be able to enjoy the surroundings from the various kinds of people that you may meet there. If they're going to a all-white congregation, they're even a mixture of there. You have Swedes, Norwegians, and Germans, and each of them have their own views about everything. So I would say go there with an open mind. Go there to learn something about who you are, as far as letting them know who you are, but also take back from some things that they can offer you, which would be good points for you. So you can interchange life experiences, which will help you later on in life as you grow older. One of the things that I don't think people understand about Martin Luther is he didn't set out to create a church. He set out to correct the problems that the Catholic faith was doing. He wanted to set the record straight. And this is how we should worship, not by some of the doctrine that the Catholic Church was preaching at that time. So for him to say he started a religion was totally not in his background or not in his thought process. As he died and later on, people of that the Lutheran that followed him decided to form a Lutheran doctrine type of thing. To learn about Martin Luther in my earlier years was just a wonderful tool to build my strength and my the wisdom of the church and what they were trying to do. And so when Pastor Nelson came in and integrated, it just brought to life what Martin Luther, what he had planned and what he was talking about. Even though they might not have been African Americans during that time in that area, But there were other poor people of different cultures that were there, and he wanted to include everybody. I feel Pastor Nelson was a reformer because he visualized far things in the future that other members of the church or other people couldn't see. He wanted the church to represent the whole community, African Americans, white, Hispanic, whatever race you were. He wanted the community to be reflected in his church. So when he come out and preach to his congregation, he'll see a mixture of all faces. And he believed in that, and he took it out in his belief to make sure it came to truism. It was such, for me, it was such a wonderful time to grow up in that era, to be experienced with him, because I've been to his house many times. I grew up with his children, and I was like family. The legacy would be the church was open, the church was willing to take a chance, the church was willing to go into the neighborhood, which a lot of them never associated with anybody in the community. But they were willing to take a chance to go out and knock on doors. Probably they had just as much fear of what they're going to happen when the person opens the door as the people behind the door looking out and seeing a white face. I was blessed to be on that, but I was only 10 years old. So that left a big impression on me because I would maybe talk to the adults, but I felt my job was to talk to the kids to get them to come to Sunday school. And maybe that's how the rumor got out that I had, you know, brought so many kids into Sunday school, because I would talk to all people that were my age and friends to come to go to Sunday school with me. I mean, we had a lot of fun. We did a lot of things. And those were the words that I was trying to pass to the families that we went to and the doors that we knocked on. And then the fact that I think that I was so young and the people whose doors we knocked on could see, here's a young man, African-American, like them, that is a member of this church. So I can't speak on what impact that had on them, but the impact it had on me is, here I'm inviting people of my color to come to this church, which they look out and see the white race of another color, and they said, wow, I get probably said, if he can come, I can come too. I look forward to coming here to Sunday school. I look forward to becoming being an acolyte. I look forward to serving on the things that I did as an acolyte. And I was proud of it. One of the most, to me, it was embarrassing. I went to the barber one Saturday, and I was going to serve that Sunday, and he cut all my hair off. All my hair. And I was so embarrassed to stand up in front of the congregation and serve with a bald head. You know, and I laugh at that, but that's the effect that it had on me. That I just wanted to be, as I'm serving, show my reverence. I have kids that great-grandkids that are serving, also fulfilling their role as a Lutheran church member, and they are acolytes. And when I was watching one of my grandsons serve, he didn't, you know, me being a teacher of that, he didn't bow right, or he didn't do this thing right, and I had to correct him because that's what I did. And I told him that, for one, it's a honor to serve as an acolyte. Two, you have to, when you're up there, you're showing reverence to God as an acolyte. So you bow a certain way. You don't go, and like, no, you don't do that. And then I felt myself when I was talking to him, here I am teaching again and showing a younger generation how to serve. I came to the conclusion about myself that I was only being me. I was only being a product of what my parents taught me to be and how to act. The church, as I opened, invited people in, and I thought about that, but I didn't look at that, me being a missionary. I looked at that doing my job as a member of the church, inviting people in. I was went to a Lutheran college at age 20. I was had every intention of going into the Lutheran doctrine and becoming a Lutheran minister. But as I got through courses and so forth, I prayed about it many times, and I said, Lord, you know, this is tough, you know, because the years you had to spend and so forth. I said, there must be another way that I can do this without wearing the collar. And I said, just guide and lead me to the way that you want me to be. The Lord showed me the way that to carry it out and just being myself, teaching and telling people about what happened to me as I grew up in the Lutheran church, how I felt about being in the Lutheran church, how I felt about people that I met and explained to them what the Lutheran faith was. But I wanted them to know that you can get the same thing in any faith if you believe strong enough in yourself, you believe strong enough in your goals, you believe strong enough in Jesus Christ, and that it doesn't matter what faith you have, if you believe strong enough in yourself with the help of God, then you can do anything you want to do. And it's been good for me, it's been good to me, and I'm very, very humble by my experiences here and where it's taken me, because this church set my whole foundation for my whole life. And I'm proud of that. Come to Augustana. Come to enjoy your, first of all, to have the fellowship that you want to have with a church that's associated with fellowship.
But I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother and I say, brother, help me please. But he winds up knocking me back down. But I know a change gonna come.